3:8. Good morning and welcome. Glad you're here on Facebook and YouTube Live. We've had a little technical difficulties, but we're here. We're having a little technical difficulties over here. We've either got we only used this 1 week, and either a box or a cord or something went out. So that's just where we are today. It's live, folks. And it's live. Woohoo! So here we are. Colossians 3:8. Clothe yourself with these things. Do you remember them? You know them by memory, right? Compassion, kindness, patience, humility, gentleness. How you doing with that today? Amen. We're all a work in progress, right? So here we are. We're here to worship the Lord. A few announcements this morning. If you are a guest with us, please raise your hand. We have a guest form for you. And if you will fill this out and turn it in at the Connections booth, at the conclusion of the service, we have a promise book for you. It is a book full of God's promises. There you go. Thank you. It's good to have you all here. This is our second week of our third service. We have an 8:30, a 10:30, and a 12:30. And so the 12:30 is a completely masked up with social distancing. Any speaker will have their mask off. I don't like the mumbo jumbo that comes through it, so just know that part. But otherwise, it's strict social distancing, so thank you for abiding by that. And we are a mask-up service, and of course, if you're comfortable in removing it, that's fine during this service. Tonight at 6:30, until there is a definite election of our president, we will be meeting at 6:30 for prayer right here in the sanctuary at 6:30. It is a prayer watch, so come and join us. Our Wednesday night service, midweek service, is Tuesday night. Our Wednesday night service will be Tuesday night. We will be on Facebook and YouTube also that night, so join us right here at 6:30 on Tuesday evening. We're in a can drive for the AJ Food Bank. We're asking you to bring non-perishables to our service foyer, and we have a bunch of food, so thank you for helping us with that. The bulletin is getting chock full as we are opening up ministries. You'll see there's a lot happening, and we hope to open up more ministries after the first of the year. And just pray that we do not have a COVID outbreak like we did before. Can I have an amen? Amen. Tell you what, the Lord watches over us. Have some exciting news in our women's ministries. We now have a Loves Women's Ministry Committee. And Sue Ruth Hart, yes, give the Lord a clap in. We have had very successful ministries, and now we have a committee over this. And Sue Ruth Hart was here earlier in the first service, and she is our director. And I think I saw Mary June Ficarra. There she is. She is on our committee, along with Vicki Green, saw her, and Mary Jo Thomas. So we are happy to announce that. You'll be learning more, and we hope to, as I said, open up some more ministries after the first of the year. We're going to push forward in the Lord. We still have plans for our future, and our future is bright in the Lord. Can I have an amen? Amen. Yeah, I'm kind of cheerleader today. Before we get into our worship, let me just give you a little update on our building. May I do so? Financial part and the interworkings part. You can see not much has been happening on the exterior, still working on a few things there to get the stonework up, but we're doing a lot of work on the inside. Our mappers are here. They're doing a wonderful job finishing the wiring and the plumbing, and we've got insulation going in and sheetrock going up, and they're doing some mudding over there, some exciting things. Now, a couple of weeks ago, actually it's been a couple of months ago, I call the meeting that I had, it was a drop dead come to Jesus meeting, one Wednesday afternoon with Fred, the superintendent of, he was the superintendent at that time with Southwest Design, and we were crunching some numbers, and a couple of days later I got the numbers on what it's going to take to get into the building. Now, we knew that we were on a $2.1 million project, and before we even broke ground, we were already over 10%. Why? The architect had drawn up a wooden structure. Well, that didn't pass code at AJ, the city of AJ. That was a $180,000 difference. Wow. We're almost 10% over budget with that one item. We get everything approved. We go into AJ, city of AJ, to pick up our permits. And I believe the permits were between $5,000 and $8,000. I didn't check my figures before I got here, but that's a minuscule number. And then they said, oh, but there's a $38,000 development fee that you owe now. So we were $180,000 over budget. Now we're another $40,000 over budget. So before we broke ground, we were $220,000 over budget. And then how many of you have ever built anything? You know your budget's going to be 10, 15, maybe 20% over. Well, our part just to get in the building is now $500,000. Yeah, I'll let that sink in for a moment. I've been waiting for the right time. It's Thanksgiving, and we're praising the Lord for all the accomplishments. And then I unload that on you. Now, here, you got to hear the bad news before the good news is news. And oh, by the way, I ask everybody, are you the one with the $500,000? I'm like, on Facebook, are you the one? On YouTube, are you the one with the $500,000? Maybe it's $5. Maybe you could send to our building fund $5. Hey, we receive it. Someone the other day, we wrote a letter explaining our project. Somebody gave us their name and address. We wrote them a letter, and they made a commitment for 1 year, $100 a month. Praise the Lord. We will get there for the glory of God. God didn't start this project to leave us high and dry. He knew all about this. So we're just, I'm giving you some prayer. Pray for a $500,000 to come in so we can finish the building. Will you do that for me? Can I have an amen?
Amen.
For those that will pray. So that's kind of where you are. Here's the good news. Pastor had I stepped out by faith when we started our capital campaign. I thought, man, if we could raise $250,000 in 3 year commitments, wow. We far surpassed a $500,000 months ago. So you just say, Pastor, you need a little more faith. Come on, tell me. Pastor, you need a little more faith. Everybody with me. Pastor, you need a little more faith. We're believing that God has blessed us. He's helped us raise over $500,000, $600,000. In fact, a few weeks ago, we have already raised and spent almost right around $800,000 for the glory of God. It's coming in for His kingdom and His glory. Everything, a sheet of plywood now, used to cost $7 last year. It's $32 now. Prices are outrageous. So just wanted you to get that little tidbit. God's still on the throne. He's not worried about a $500,000. I'm just telling Him, would you please sell some of those cattle on your Thousand Hills? All right, it's time to worship. I did my little spiel. God bless you. If you can give, God bless you. We receive it in Jesus' name. Now we're going to give Him praise. We're going to minister to Him. Give Him praise and honor today through our worship. Let's stand together.
I hear the roar.
name it is the name of Jesus.
It saves. It reconciles. The name of Jesus, demons have to flee. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise your name, Lord. We're going to go to prayer. I'm going to ask our prayer warriors that anoint with oil to come, and we're going to anoint you with oil. If you are uncomfortable in doing so, you may ask for a prayer cloth if you would just lift up a hand. But we're going to the Lord with needs, and these folks are masked up. We ask that you be masked up. If you come forward, if you'd be so kind, just protect one another. And we're going to pray for you, asking you to take a step of faith. Jesus, the name above all names, he is here and he is in this place. He's at your home, wherever you are, and he wants to minister to you right here, right now. Aligned to do so, we're going to take a moment of prayer. We're going to continue to worship, and then we will have someone come and pray the corporate prayer in Jesus' name. So step out by faith. Take your needs list at home and begin to pray over your needs and over your families and ask God to do a special thing right here today in Jesus' name. God bless you.
His little pea brain has never had before. Our dear precious Heavenly Father, we come before you giving praise and glory to your name and the name of your Son, Jesus. Lord, I declare my love for you, my faith in you, and my fear of you. Lord, you said, I am the Lord that healeth thee. You said, I am a God that cannot lie. Jesus said, I give you authority over all the power of Satan. Jesus said, by my stripes you are healed. It's in the Bible about the trials you're going to go through if you follow the Lord. It's in the New Testament where Jesus said, the trials you're going to go through if you follow him. We know that sin causes sickness. But we know that sin comes from Satan. Jesus said, I give you authority over all the power of Satan. Amen. Now, Lord, we hold our pastor and his family up to you. We pray for their protection. I ask in the name of Jesus Christ that you open the gates of heaven and you let the Holy Ghost pour out upon this church and your protection. Lord, the fervency that we pray with makes a difference. And we know that your will is going to be done in the end. Now in the name of Jesus, I ask that you bless this service and bless this church and bless our pastor. Amen.
Oh, yeah. Time now to go to communion. You at home in Facebook and YouTube land, if you get your elements ready, we'll be ready to go in just a couple of seconds here. If you did not pick up your elements in the back, we'll give you about 22 seconds to go get them. I think after many weeks that I've been leading in communion, you know that communion is very, very important to me. I consider it the testimony and declaration of my full faith in Jesus Christ. First, to believe that he was born of a virgin. Second, as he predicted through all his ministry, that he was going to go to the cross and suffer death, but with the promise of rising again in 3 days. That's the trinity of our faith, I believe. That's the foundation of our faith. One of my favorite persons in the Bible is Paul. We have an awful lot of common, except the name. But it seemed that communion was very important to him. For he wrote these words in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Do you proclaim that today for you? Do you claim the healing from his broken body? If you do so, let's proclaim together by partaking in the blood, or in the bread. Thank you. The word also says that took the cup and he raised the cup. The cup is a representation of the blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary. It didn't trickle out like when you cut your finger. It gushed out through his side. And it flows today for us to continue to wash us and cleanse us from our sin. Let's together proclaim the washing of the sin. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your work on the cross. We thank you for not turning from us when you could have. And we proclaim today that our faith says that your broken body healed us, and the blood has washed us clean. Amen and amen. God's pleased with us for our worshiping Him in song and in prayer. And now we have a chance to praise Him with our giving. We are still not taking or receiving our offerings the traditional way, but we would ask today that if you have an offering, we have 3 drop boxes in the lobby area where you can drop your monies, your checks off. Also the Joash chest in the front here on the altar. You can mail it in, or you could pay online, or come visit us at the church and just drop it by. We're glad to say hello to you and maybe have a little prayer. You know, you've all been so faithful through all this crazy times that we're in. And we just thank you for that. And we want you to be blessed because of what you have done.
Thank you, Pastor Bob, and worship.
The Lord is in this place today. I trust that you have felt Him on Facebook and YouTube. God is very real.
And He wants to work in our lives today. You that are in the sanctuary, just don't pay any attention to this. It will be out of sequence with what's happening. there's about a 15-second delay, but those that are at home, it will make complete sense. So if you'll watch the monitors on either side of me, you'll be in good shape. Wow. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. It's good to see you. It's good that the Lord can do whatever He wants, whenever He wants. And Sam scared the fire out of me. He scared Jesus right into me. I was like, good lands, what's going on? He was getting blessed. I don't know if you all heard it at home or not, but it was like a sonic boom, scared us to death in here. The Lord works in a lot of ways. Sometimes it's very subtle, sometimes a mighty rushing wind. Sometimes there were several just laid out here at the altar, and it's okay. The Lord moves. Just be receptive to Him, and He'll give you what you need. We hope that through the message today that you will become spiritually enriched and encouraged today. And I don't know about you, but the physical body needs fuel too. And we have a Rudy's fundraiser. It goes all to our building program. And there are tickets available. And this young lady to my left, to your right, has tickets for you. If you would like to purchase those for $10, we get $5 from Rudy's, so it's the best restaurant fundraiser that we have. Most of them give 10 to 20%, 15%. They give us half of the proceeds, come back to us. Can you say amen? Amen. Amen. The title of the message last week was God is good.
All the time.
Today, the devil is a liar.
All the time.
Next week, prayer changes things.
All the time.
So that works. The subtitle, or the main title this morning, the devil is a liar, but then there are four lies that ruin the world. And anytime you talk negative about the devil, you know, things are going to happen. They just happen. And we've had quite a spiritual battle going on here today in the sanctuary, before the service, during the service. This thing's not working, that thing's not working, whatever. We're still here to praise and worship the Lord, regardless of what he tries to throw at us, Satan, the devil. We are conquerors and we will endure. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
So last week, the three-part series, I had a lot of fun with that one. Gonna have some fun today, because we can claim the devil is a liar and stand firm on that foundation. And my question to you today, what do you think some of the lies are? And my mind went to, well, maybe communism, maybe humanism, maybe new ageism, maybe evolution. What isms do you have? And yet in Genesis, it tells us four lies that Satan started with in the book of Genesis, and they're the biggest lies. And we see in John chapter 8, verse 44, what Jesus says about O Slewfoot. Did you know that the devil, Satan, he is the master liar, and everything from that, he spins out of that. Everything, every lie comes from him. God created, so Satan doesn't like it. Are you following me? Whatever God created, he created you, so Satan is against you. Are you getting that? God created truth and love and peace and kindness, and so Satan is against all of that. And he's a very good liar. Satan, the devil, he's a good liar. He's very deceptive in his lies. And he does it covertly sometimes, and sometimes he does it very matter-of-factly. It's just blatant. So Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. Now the serpent said to the woman, has God indeed said? Now there's a question already. He's starting to throw that doubt in Eve's mind already. You shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden. But, verse 3, big transition. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God said, you shall not eat, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. Now that's the first time that that's been mentioned. Nobody has died thus far. Do you understand? God created and nothing had died. It was a perfect world. They were in the Garden of Eden, and God said, you can touch of anything. You can eat of anything except this one tree. Do not eat or you'll die. Verse 4, the serpent said to the woman, you shall surely not die. You won't die. Come on. God is lying to you. You won't die. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Now, Lord, would you bless the reading of the word? Help us to get in our minds and our spirits what you have for us today in knowing that Satan is a liar, but God is good. Amen and amen. And we can go to Isaiah chapter 20, chapter 5, verse 20, where it says, woe to you. When you start calling good evil and evil good, I don't watch much news anymore, but we're all over that. I mean, it's all over the news. You can't get away from it. People are calling good evil and evil good. It's there. Now, you need to know, and I need to know, that the devil, Satan, is the father of all lies. Out of all these fundamental, foundational lies, all other lies are spawned from the father of all lies. And we need to understand out of John chapter 8, verse 44, Jesus said this. He, the devil, was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. He is a liar and the father of it. Let me tell you something. You can do a wrong thing by mistake and the next time do the right thing. But if you believe the wrong thing, you will continually do the wrong thing because you believe the wrong thing. And here's society today. If I say it loud enough, strong enough, bold enough, long enough, my lie becomes a reality over time. It's truth. That's the way it is. And that is Satan's lie. Let me tell you something. Whatever it gets in your mind, whatever you believe, my Bible says in Proverbs 23:7, as a man thinketh in his heart, so he is. So we've got to get truth in our hearts. And the devil, if he can twist things, if he can get you twisted about who God is, about what God does, and what God is like, he's got you. He's got you. Gotcha. If he can twist your mind about who he is, what he does, and what God is like. Listen, the devil, Satan, is in the very first book. I just read out of Genesis. The devil is in the first book. God is telling us, beware, warning. He warned Eve and Adam, and what did they do? I want my eyes opened. Well, they got them opened. On your outline, the devil's motive, he wants to murder you. What is his method? He's going to hiss in your ear a bunch of lies. The devil wants to hiss in your ear. How many of you, now none of you ever have had the devil hiss in your ear. He's never been talking to you about stuff. Do you know how many times he said, you don't need to preach this sermon, Sonny. You don't need to do that. And did you hear in worship the mere mention of the name? There's a name with five letters in it. I want you to say his name with me.
Jesus.
Demons have to flee. Well, why would that be if it's all a bunch of lies? Satan wants you to believe a big lie. And so if he can twist your mind about who God is, his trustworthiness of his character, then the devil has you about God. He's selling you a bill of goods. And here he is in the first pages. Are you seeing it? Satan tells four big lies here attacking God's character. And he wants you to die physically. He wants you to die spiritually. He wants you to die eternally, and it's all through deception and him hissing in your ear, telling you that God is nothing but lies. You need to follow him, the devil. And he's a dirty liar. And these four foundations are going to come very clear today. And I need you to remember through this whole thing, the devil, Satan, is a liar. He's a master. Have you ever been around a master manipulator? Have you been around someone, everything that comes out of their mouths is a bunch of lies and you know it?
Yeah.
Okay? You can't believe anything that they're telling you. This is Satan. This is the devil. Now, the devil was and is an evangelist. Did you know that he is an evangelist? And Eve was the first convert of his evangelism. So, rather than the four spiritual laws, Satan wants to give you the four spiritual flaws. Here they are. Are you ready for these four big lies? Lie number one, God is not loving. You see, Satan started hissing in Eve's ear, and the devil's a liar, and he planted that seed of doubt in her ear. Look, if God was really a loving God, which he is not, he would not tell you not to have of that, because once you eat of that, your eyes are going to be opened. So God's not loving. He's actually cruel. He's very harsh because he's not allowing you to have of that fruit. How would a loving God not want you to have of that fruit? Last week we discussed for the whole time, God is good.
All the time. God is good.
So we know the foundation that God is good. And Satan wants to attack that, and God is not cruel, he is not harsh, he is not unloving, but there are things he put, he put boundaries around some things. And as a child growing up, how come I got to obey all the can'ts? I can't do this, I can't do that, I can't. And Eve might have been playing that old done me wrong song. I can't believe God's kept me from that. Satan says that I'm going to have life, and my eyes will be opened. And the devil says, look, my pleasures are better than God's pleasures. You're going to enjoy my pleasures more than God's pleasures. Really? Let's go to Psalm 37. Delight thyself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Now, that's really cruel, isn't it? If you seek God and you worship him and you serve him, he's going to give you the desires of your heart. But you have to understand, when you worship him and when you serve him and when you get into his word, those desires that are in your heart come from God. Don't you just love the way he works? How about Psalm 84:11? The Lord thy God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. Now listen to this. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. But there are still boundaries. There are some things, there are some pleasures we're not to partake of. Anybody there? Is my microphone on? He has boundaries. God is a loving God because he cares for you. And if you follow him, you have eternal life. Hallelujah. Stop letting Satan hiss in your ear. There's no pleasure in serving God. How boring of a life is that? How rich of a life is that? We should be saying and we should be trumpeting that God is good all the time and he has treasures. And if we don't get them here on this earth, woohoo! We get them in heaven. It's a win-win situation. So God is loving. Lie number two, God is not truthful. The devil throws doubt in your mind and starts casting doubt about God's truthfulness and faithfulness to you. You see, the devil wanted Eve to believe God had lied to her. And he's implying God's word cannot be trusted. You see, anytime we talk about the devil, it's always opposite of God. Listen, any person, teacher, professor, pundit, pastor, when skepticism about authority, have you seen anything about skepticism on authority in the news? Wow. Accuracy, infallibility, authenticity of the Word of God. Satan wants to throw that skepticism, that doubt in your hearts and lives. The devil throws skepticism at you, doubting the Word of God. He starts hissing in you. That's not really what he's trying to tell you. Relativism. There is no fixed truth. There are a lot of theories out there, and you might as well believe they're all roads lead to heaven. There's one road, my Bible says. And so all these isms come back in. And there's the thesis. This is from Adrian Rogers. Over here is capitalism. Antithesis is the opposite, which is communism. The synthesis is socialism. Now, you can take that home and you start studying that and you work on that. I don't have time to go through all that, okay? So, what the point is, there is relativism. There's no fixed truth. There is no anchor. All theories lead to heaven. There is no absolutes. There are no absolutes. And the devil is trying to destroy the truthfulness of God. Just start reading the Word of God. It will liberate you. It will free you. The boundaries, if we obey them, only give you eternal rewards, which is heaven. And yes, there are rewards here for living a good life with the Lord Jesus Christ. So Satan throws all these isms at you. You need to remember, I need to remember, he's the big daddy of all lies. He's the big cheese. He's the father of all lies. And where reason cannot wade, faith must swim. Adrian Rogers. Start swimming in faith. Like I told you, in the very beginning of our building campaign, I thought, my, if we could just raise $250,000 in 3 years, how phenomenal would that be? God has blessed. God has blessed tithes and offerings. He has blessed in other ways. And just look, we had to start a third service for the mask up. God's doing a work. We're having souls saved. We're reaching ways we never reached before for the glory of God. Amen. The third lie, lie number three, God is not righteous. That's what Satan tries to tell you. He says, you shall not surely die. The devil wanted Eve to believe God would not really, really, really hold Eve's sin against her. Listen, God is a just God and he punishes. Look, we are not bad parents because we used a wooden spoon. I don't know if some of you are watching that, but Mama carried a wooden spoon. And a lot of times all she had to do was show that thing after they had been whooped a time or two. I don't know about y'all. My backside hurt several times when I was growing up, and I don't have any effects from it. I'm just fine. Sometimes it hurts when the Lord disciplines us, and a lot of times it's called pruning. Doesn't that feel so good when He prunes, when He disciplines us? He's too good not to punish sin because he's holy and righteous. And we sang about that this morning. He's a holy God. Holy, holy is our Lord God Almighty. He's God. Now you need to write this down. Satan wants to tell you there is no hell. There is no hell. It's okay. That's too strong of a punishment. How could a loving God send you to hell? Number one. I've told you this last week and weeks before. God doesn't send you. You write your own ticket to hell by not obeying God's word. Now, let's go to the Supreme Court for a moment. Let's take this hell issue to the Supreme Court. I believe that the Supreme Court would vote no it's too hard of a punishment. It's too cruel and unusual punishment to send anybody to hell. So we're going to veto that punishment. Listen, God is a righteous God, and he shows you a choice to live. You can live for him and have eternity, or you can live not for the Lord Jesus Christ, and there is hell. It's a literal hell. Get into your Bible and read. It's hot. There's no water. Have you been in the desert lately when we were over 115 and there's no water? You're thirsty. You will have no for a long time. No water, no relief for eternity. Or the good news is, accept him as Lord and Savior, and you have a reward of dancing on the streets of glory and singing around the throne, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." God is righteous. The fourth lie is, God is not gracious. You see, Satan's temptation here is for Eve to believe God's plans for her were not good because God was withholding something from her. And he says, "You are your own God. God is lying to you. He's not gracious. You are your own God. And you need to sing the song, handed it my way." That was way off tune and everything, but boy, did it ring a bell. I did it my way. No, we need to do it God's way. Here's why. Jeremiah 29:11. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." We have a hope for today and a bright hope and a bright promise of tomorrow. Hallelujah. That's right. 1 Corinthians 2:9. "Eye has not seen, ear not heard, nor ear heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him." Did you know? I got a secret for you. Press in. Come on. Come on. Right now, this building's being prepared for a future date. Oh, but that's here on earth. Right now, for those who are saved, he's preparing, don't tell anybody, a mansion for you in heaven. Wow. We ought to be spreading that good word. He's preparing a mansion for you now. Adam's rib, Satan's fib, women's lib, Adrian Rogers. Just had to throw that one in there. I believe in fair pay. I believe in equal treatment. I believe in all this stuff. And my wife is a great helpmate that God has sent to me. Hallelujah. We work together for the glory of God. If the devil is out to deceive us, how will we overcome? I'm glad you asked. Revelation 12:11. "And they overcame by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death." So here's how to overcome. Calvary's conquest. The blood of the Lamb. On the cross, the devil's back was broken. He is broken. He is defeated for the glory of God. Can I have an amen? Let me tell you something. It's by the blood. Our salvation, our redemption of sin, our forgiveness of sin is through the blood of the Lamb. We partook of that together. Amen and amen. Discover Jesus when? Now. Ask him to forgive you of your sins one more time. Ask him to come into your heart and life, and he will do it, and you will conquer Satan hissing in your ear. By courageous confession, by the word of their testimony. Can anybody testify here that the Lord has forgiven you of your sins and you're living to the very best of your ability for him? Can I have an amen? Can I have a hand in the house of the Lord? A gracious, a courageous confession. I live for the Lord Jesus Christ. Thirdly, be complete by complete commitment. Shh. It's not politically correct to use the word commitment anymore. I'm old school. Commitment. I don't want a wishy-washy, well, maybe I'll be there and maybe I won't. I like definite times. I like definite commitments from people. I'll get it done for the glory of God. They loved not their lives unto death. In other words, I will serve the Lord, and while I'm living, I'm going to, until I draw my last breath, I will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Amen. Now, in conclusion, we watched this cartoon a million times if we watched it once when the kids were growing up. It's a cartoon, the fox is Robin Hood. And you just have to get this. The next time Satan, and I, every time I have said this from the pulpit or in private, this is what I think of about Satan hissing in my ear.
Oh, you've kissed your last. Yes.
That little 24 seconds in that 2-hour movie, maybe we'll stop hissing in my ear, tie his neck in a knot, put him in a basket and sit on him. But really, all you have to do is speak the name of Jesus. There are 5 letters that you need to speak. J-E-S-U-S. And Satan must flee from you. Can I have an amen? Amen. So I hope you get that visual next time.
You hear Satan hissing in your ear, just say, be gone in Jesus' name. Stop hissing in my ear. Do y'all get it? Do you get it on Facebook, YouTube? You got it. Let's stand together. Hallelujah. Satan, stop hissing in my ear. You have no authority here. I am a conqueror by the blood of the Lamb. Amen and amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our time together. Satan, you are a liar. The devil is a liar, and we stand firm on the promises of God. You are loving. You are righteous. You are truthful. And yes, you are the soon coming King. We worship you, we adore you, and we know that you're our Lord and Savior if we accept you as that. Now, Jesus, I pray for those that are with us and those that are on YouTube and Facebook. We thank you, Lord, for them being with us. I pray, Lord, that your face would shine upon them. May we put that hedge of protection around us, keeping us from old Slewfoot, and may we be strong in putting him in his place. Which is away from us. In the name of Jesus, we plead the blood. In the name of Jesus, we ask that the angels would put a hedge of protection around us. Keep us in your loving care, Lord. We know you're a loving God, you're a good God, and we know that prayers change things. So, Lord, we thank you for being in our midst today. Bless us as we leave this place. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. God bless you. We'll see you next time. It's good to have you on Facebook and YouTube. Have a great day. Happy Thanksgiving. Give the Lord praise and thanks. We'll see you Tuesday night.